from I Have Called Nostalgia. I just want you to tell me a bit about your memories of growing up in Guyana. What are some of your fondest memories?
Oh Lord, that's a long story.
Tell me a short one. Tell me a nice story that you, when you rock in your hammock, that you remember.
Yeah, the night I was talking about that here, and my nieces and nephews were laughing their belly full. Trinidadians say Bodhi, we say Bora. I was a young boy in high school, and the neighbor was planting a garden, and the Bora vine was running on the school fence, which was the school fence. And you know how those vines are delicate. And the Bora, green Bora, is nice to eat raw. So all the students, the children who could reach, they were picking up Bora and they're eating. They pulled the lady vine and cut it up. And I did my thing. I had one. She knows me because our home was opposite the school. This lady went over to my father when he came from work as a cane cutter, hot and sweaty, and said, "Your son steal me Bora." Well, she said, "Your son thief me Bora." Which one of them? I started crying right away because you know what you're going to get. Little boy, 6 or 7. That one pointed me out. So my father said, "You know, I want you all to grow up and take an education. You go to school with teeth, give people them Bora, go cut a whip and come back. You gotta get 6 lashes. He was very disciplined in his disciplining. He didn't brutalize you. Take a whip and flag you behind. So he put me across a bench. 1, 2, 3. Mind you, I started crying from the time I dropped on the bench. "Why are you getting licks?" "Because I picked Nanny." I called the lady Nanny, an older woman. "You didn't pick her Bora, you stole her Bora, you thief your Bora." "Yep, I thief the Bora." "How many lashes did you get?" I said, "I can't remember." So he said, "Start back from 1. So I go 1, 2, 3. "I would rather you all kill, I might defend you, but you mustn't be a thief. I don't want anybody to be a thief. How many lashes did you get?" "Can't remember, start back from 1. And every time he will go 3 and 4 and stop to ask you if you know why you're being flogged. So you must understand that this punishment is necessary. And then how much you get now? I can't remember, start back from 1. And he reached a stage where my mother couldn't take it, and nobody could have said anything while we are being punished or anybody else is being punished by way of whipping, flogging. My mother said, six, you fool, holler 6. So I said, 6 past 6, 6, 6. By the time that he was going away with his whip, man. I have a brother who died. Well, I had a brother then. He was working at the Auditor General's office in Guyana. And the man did the count. When it was done, he said, "You know how many lashes you get?" I said, yeah, whatever. 24 lashes. Now, here's how that ended. My father said, "You go to school. You could have learned to count. But you go to thief Bora, you can't count from 1 to 6. That's where you get 24. Now, it was his way of disciplining you, but you must know why you're being disciplined, what wrong you did. And so for me, that was a hell of a learning lesson. 24 lashes for 1 Bora, you know how that ended? The next day I went to school, my behind was sore. I went on hands and knees, and I parted the picket fence at the bottom, and I went in, hands and knees, and I was massaging the Bora plant, these young ones, like this. Oh, I destroyed about 2 banks. And the lady was folding her, she had her hand folded, and all she did was a finger like this. You're proper bad. But then I figured I didn't deserve 24 lashes for just 1 Bora. Give me 24 now. She did not complain to my father. So I got the 24 and it was punishment. I said, "Fine, I already got punishment. Let me go do this now." But it was my way of justifying the licks that I got. I got 24 lashes for nothing, man. 1 Bora. Now if I get 24, I don't care. But I didn't get any because she didn't complain. But, you know, there are other things that we can look at, but there are too many, man. Too many good days, good times, rough times, but it made you strong.
Charn, you're a man that says it as it is, you know? How do you think you would be received when you go back to Guyana?
Let me tell you now how I'm seeing that. The fear of the danger that I might be faced with is what is sort of causing me to weigh up and down. I have two grandsons. I don't want to part from them now. I want to be able to see them, or I can video call them whenever. One of them turned two in November, on the 23rd of November, and the other one turned three, the elder of the two, on the 28th of June. So having been here, I thank Kemraj for that. Having been in self-exile, I got a chance to spend time with them and I see them grow. I enjoy my grandson. So. But going back, yes, I would still like to go back to my practice, my friends, my life in Guyana. I have nothing here, except relatives, you know.
What were all these months, well, how would you describe the months? As you say you were in exile, how would you describe the feelings and the thoughts that you've been having and reflecting on that day in Parliament?
You know what, Jennifer, living outside here, I did not have to go anywhere because I've lived in Canada for 20-something years before I went back to Guyana. I know Canada, but I had no reason to go anywhere and I couldn't go out and spend money because I don't drink. What would I go to a club for the 19 months, 20 months? I went to New York a couple of times. I went to Trinidad for the court case a couple of times. And I'll tell you this much. One friend, and I don't want to name him because he said, Charan, forget this. He paid the airfare for me to go to Trinidad one time. He's a wonderful friend. He used to lecture at the Technical Institute in Amsterdam. And he said, man, he paid the airfare for me and he gave me, I think it was about $800 or $1,000 US to go to Trinidad on one occasion. These are people who, well, not everybody could afford to do that. That's the other thing. But a lot of people. I was teaching in Kanji. There's a young boy that I used to teach then who's now a big man, got grandchildren and has a small business here. He met me at a mandir one time and he came and he shook my hand. He said, sir, I'm proud of you. He still calls me sir, and he's our grandfather. But he gave me $100. Again, those little gestures, I think I said it in my last post, the calls, the little discussion that we had, the thank you, they encouraged me to stay and feel that what I've done was worth doing. And so I was grateful, I am grateful to all those who verbally, whether by a line, Charan, you're a hero, we are proud of you. They called, they gave me a 50 cents, a $50, $100, and to help me going. And then some boys in Florida, Orlando in particular, who did pretty much the same thing. But that's how I survived. It wasn't a challenge in a way, because as I told you, I sold my assets in Guyana to get money for me to continue living. And I get to move around, I get to meet with people, I see relatives, I see friends. When you go somewhere, somebody just come up and give you a hug. And thank you, went to mandirs. Some of the pandits were very, very vocal. You know, all of that was encouragement. And so I can safely say, I was encouraged by a lot of people, hundreds of them that I've never seen. Never seen their faces, even on a Facebook thing, but they sent me a little post to say, we're proud of you, what you did for Guyana and the Guyanese. That was encouragement enough, you know.
Well,